we restrict to civil wars. Then it turns out that since 1950 till today, more than half of the countries have experienced situations of civil war.
If you look at interstate wars fought during that period, like the Vietnam War, the Korean War, and so forth, right? There's maybe been about 22, 25 of those. The number of lives that have been lost in internal conflicts rivals the total amount of battle deaths in these interstate wars.
This is the major impediment for growth nowadays. When trying to explain why foreign aid sometimes has failed to promote development in a country, then most of the cases it ends up because of the existence of civil wars or potential civil wars.
The first is that economic development in general brings conflict down. The second is that it's economic inequality across people that tends to generate conflict. And finally, it tells us that very often conflict is organized along ethnic lines rather than economic lines, and therefore a large bulk of the conflicts that we do see are not really fundamentally economic in nature. So what we do in our paper is look very critically at these three points.
It's not necessarily true that the richer is the country, then the less likely is that there is social conflict. First, we observe countries that are pretty rich, and nevertheless, they have very intense social conflicts. Secondly, because there are more issues at stake. I mean, it is true that then people earn more as the country becomes richer, but it is also true that there is more to gain.
Economic inequality may not always be conflictual. The reason is that while there is certainly a lot of resentment, there's a lot of frustration at the fact that some groups are extremely rich and other groups are poor, the poor may not have the wherewithal to translate their frustrations into explicit social violence. But very often what we do see are similar people, for example, engaged in the same business enterprises, but of different religious backgrounds. People entering the labor market, some are immigrants, some are natives. People who are farmers, some who hold larger plots of land than others. People who are engaged actually in similar, not dissimilar activities, those are the groups that actually tend to get into conflict. So it's in here that a political entrepreneur can come in and say, you are immigrants, they are natives, right? And by drawing these ethnic divisions or markers, can create well-defined senses of us and them. Therefore, in the end, you see two groups of similar occupational structure, divided only in religion or ethnicity, fighting with each other, and you say, oh, this is not an economic conflict. But the fact of the matter is that it's profoundly an economic conflict.
So if we have class warfare, as it has been in Europe over the past 200 years, then in fact we have succeeded in designing the institutions that can cope with it, distributing money from rich to poor, giving free education, free health. Now, do those institutions play the same role when translated into another situation? There, I think we will need to come with new, fresh ideas, think of the situation with an open mind, and try to understand the specificities of those countries so that to be able to design the best possible institutions that take on board the specificities of those countries.